It's my pleasure to be here with you. So let me start this. One of the things that I would require you to do is keep your cell phones with the data connection on. Definitely the voice of it will be off. Keep the voice part of it in silent. Don't put your phone in aircraft mode. Keep the data connection on, because we will do a poll, okay, as we go along. So let me look at what we have today. It's off? Yeah, it is on. Okay, yes. Yes, it is on, okay? So what we will do is, the outline that I have is basically a four-part outline. Understanding impact itself, your view and the purpose on work, and there are the seven spheres of influence, also known as seven mountains of influence, which you might have heard, but I want to bring it in context of this. And then we will look at Daniel chapter 1 and look at the five tips on how we all, as believing Christians in the marketplace, can influence under challenges. Okay? So let's understand impact. And for impact, the formula for impact that I have, which you may want to note down, is I, which is impact, is equal to E divided by AT. I'm very conscious of the acronym that I put there, because you may be thinking of lunch. But don't worry, I am going to give you food for thought while your thoughts are still on the food. Okay? So I equal to E divided by AT. I is impact, E is effort, A is area, and T is time. So the question that I want to ask you is, if we were to increase impact, should we necessarily increase effort? Yes? Answer is no. Okay? If you understand mathematics, there is some number on the numerator and some numbers on the denominator. What should we also do? Decrease the area. And very specifically, decrease the time. See, we are working in our whatever responsibilities, and we want to create impact for God, impact for our Lord. But in the process of creating that impact, we don't have to necessarily increase the effort. On the other hand, if we focus, if we bring down the area of influence, and if we also create what we call breakthrough moments, you will be in a position to create a greater impact. Mathematically, if the area is close to zero, very small, and if the time is very close to zero, what will the impact be? Infinity. Okay? Before I go forward, I want to just get a clarity check. How many of you in this room can speak? Oh, wow. Okay. No, but looking at the silence, I was wondering if we have differently abled people also. So all of you can speak. So please speak out. Okay? So if we narrow, if you want, you can write down, if you chase two rabbits, both of them will escape. We have to focus our energies in order to create impact. So that's the formula. Now let me go forward into our view on the purpose of work. And this is where I want the people to click the hyperlink. And I want you to go to www.menti.com and key in the code. And they will bring the screen in a little while. The code is 212007. So go to menti.com on your phone and key in the code 212007. Okay? And then answer, is work a result of sin, is the question that I'm asking. We are going to work on a daily basis. That work that we are doing for this so-called secular companies, is that a result of sin? Okay? Two people have answered. Three, go on. Okay? Or 212007. 212007. 212007. See, the problem, and I instantly faced it as soon as I entered the hall, our resolution has gone a little bit haywire, but that's, we are not here to fix that. If the resolution was proper, the number would have come on top. 21007, 30 people have answered, 32 people have answered, 34, 39. See, the number of people who are answering is there on the bottom left. 49 people have answered. Okay. Go on and give your candid answer. The reason why we like this kind of polling is confidentiality is assured. We don't want to embarrass you by saying, okay, who all believe, yes, raise your hand, and who all believe, then you will give what I would call a politically correct answer. So you, 80 people have answered, and from what I am told, there are close to 214 people, right? So the number should be as close to 214. Just key in, go to www.menti.com, and the options are there. You can click yes. If you believe work is a result of sin, say yes. If you believe work is not a result of sin and you are sure about it, say no. But if you are not sure, then say not sure, don't know, or not sure. 107 people have answered. Okay? Right, 112. We are getting an indication of where we are going, 113. Okay, now I want to look at the specific number of people. 24 people as of now believe that work is either a result of sin or they are not sure. And if we extrapolate it, 100 verses 116, in my opinion, about 40 people in this group believe that work is a result of sin. Can you imagine these 40 people going to work on Monday? Are you able to see the result of this? And then when work is a result of sin, and they will consider their boss, I don't want to give you any extrapolation there. Work is not a result of sin. Now you can bring the screen back, 124. Okay, you can bring the screen back into our thing. Okay, now let's go back to the screen. The PPT. Okay, yes. Work is not a result of sin, and I'll give you some verses. Genesis chapter 1 verse 28. The very first command that God gave to us is to be productive. Be fruitful and multiply. If I were to paraphrase it, it is be productive and then be reproductive. We have taken the second part of it very seriously, India and China. But we need to be very clear. In fact, my mandate is you can't be reproductive until you're productive. Because you'll reproduce after your own kind. That's a tall order. Okay? So make sure that we understand the very first command, way before sin came, God asked us to be productive. Genesis chapter 2 verse 15, God took Adam to the garden and said, work at it. Work this. God himself worked for 6 days. Now, for those of you who are in doubt, let me give you where your thought could have come from, and that is from Genesis chapter 3 verse 17. Work is not a result of sin, but toil is a result of sin. That means you put in all your hard work, but the desired outcome is not there. That is where we need to be conscious of. In the New Testament, John chapter 9 verse 4, the Lord Jesus is actually saying, we need to, and I'm using the Message translation, we need to be energetically at work for the one who sent me here. In the NIV it says, as long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent us. We need to understand that work is a mandate. Sin has got nothing to do with it. Toil is the result of sin. That means we put in hard work and the efficiency does not come out. Don't worry about my face there. Bring the screen there. Okay? Okay? So what we need to be very careful about is this concept. And since this is the rule, what we need to ask for, a prayer that all of us need to pray is Psalm 90 verse 17. May the favor of the Lord our God rest upon us. Establish thou the work of our hands. Yes, establish thou the work of our hands. On Monday morning, as you go to work, the prayer that you need to pray for yourself, for your colleagues, and for your siblings, and for all your friends in Christ, is the work that they do, let it be established. There are a lot of time. In my 36 years of life, you know, the first few years, I was in technical product development, programming. I started as a unit systems administrator. I went on into product development, and then I went into program management. I have done my work. But the result is not there. There are various other forces that are there which bring your effectivity down. And then for a large amount of time, for about 18 years, I was in sales and marketing. I did what I wanted to, what the company wanted me to, what was required of me to do. But the outcome was not there. Why? Because the favor is not there. There are other forces that are at work, and most of you will know what I'm talking about. You've done your best. But you need the favor of God. Now, I'm on the recruiting panel for leading management institutes in our country. And several times, I'm the industry person, and there are academic people, and there is somebody from the institution, and the candidate comes. While all the objective parameters are there, your CGPA in your graduation and your CAT score or your MAT score or your ZAT score or whatever else that is there, your 10 standard marks and your 12 standard marks, there is a lot of subjectivity in the interview. And at that point in time, we take a decision. And that decision is a subjective decision. So my prayer, if there is a candidate that is going, is may the favor of the Lord rest upon you. May you find favor in the eyes of the interviewer. Our appraisal happens. And of course, in most organizations, the annual appraisal period is now getting away. The bell curve is kind of getting obsolete. But wherever that appraisal is happening, that time, while you talk about the halo effect and the horn effect and whatever else effect, in reality, there is subjectivity. We need to pray for God's favor. Solomon, the wise man in the East, this is what he said. He was the richest man. In Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 24, he says, there is nothing better that a man can do than to eat and drink and find satisfaction in his work. Elsewhere, he says, satisfaction in his toilsome labor. As a child of God, we need to find satisfaction in our work. And that does not mean only the spiritual work. Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 and 24 very clearly says, whatever you do, whatever. You're a plumber, no problem. Do it to the glory of God. You're a carpenter, no problem. Do it to the glory of God. You're a manager, no problem. Do it to the glory of God. See, we, at some churches, have got this hierarchy. That there are some people who are doing God's service and there are others who are not doing God's service. Well, that's not true in the real world. You know, I happen to be in the what we would call the corporate world. And several times people say, brother, what is this? You're so gifted, you're so talented, you're so used of the Lord. Why don't you get into ministry? And I tell them, what is wrong with you? They tell me, what is wrong with me? Why don't you get into the ministry? And I tell them, what is wrong with you? I'm already in the ministry. But that ministry is different. I know when I joined the last company, there was this person, a good friend of mine, who came and talked to me and said, brother, we heard that you work for the we know that you work for the Tatas and you're considering working for so-and-so company. How can you do it? And he talked to me for a good 45 minutes. And after talking for a good 45 minutes, he was, oh, this is Badmashi. I don't know what all he said. Is this and that? How can you spoil your testimony by going and working there? And after all that, I said, thank you. And I'm so glad that we talked, because before you talked to me, I was considering and I had not yet made up my mind. But now that you have talked to me, I have made up my mind. I've taken a decision. And he said, I want to thank God that he has used me to influence you. I went and joined the company. He dropped off. See, the Lord Jesus came to save the sick and the lost. We need to understand, as Mordecai told Esther, who knows, deliverance for the Jews will come with or without you, but who knows, God has placed you into this position for such a time as this. Where we work is our ministry place. It's not just in certain places. Everywhere, whatever you do. And therefore, if you have work as a concept of sin, you better watch out. Our technology is challenged. Okay, so let's go forward. I'm pointing it to the thing. Okay, let us look at where all we must work. I'm not going to get into the details of Isaiah 2, verse 2. We must, at least for us to impact nations, we must be in seven spheres of influence. What are these seven spheres of influence? Arts and entertainment. We do not have believing Christians in arts and entertainment in the movie industry. In fact, exactly the opposite is there. Today, if you see any of the Bollywood movies, we as believing Christians are not represented properly. If they want to represent a villain, the person will be a Robert, or an Anthony, or a Peter. You know, we are not represented properly. And if you want to represent an immoral woman, she will be an Anne, or a Mary, or a Susan. And invariably, she will be very economically dressed. We are not portrayed properly. We need people. Like in US, where there are people who are going and making a difference in value-based movies, that entire platform is gone. We need to recognize that music is a calling. That ministry is a calling, arts and entertainment. Business. We do not have Christian entrepreneurs in our country. Successful entrepreneurs. If you look at US even now, the most successful fast food chain is not your McDonald's or your KFC or whatever, it is Chick-fil-A, which is closed on Sunday. If you understand anything about footfall, on Sunday is the maximum footfall. But they want to honor God. We need more people like that in our country. The reason why we are not getting those people is because we don't consider business as a calling. We need to have people in that area. The third one, church or religion. You look at it. How many of us are moving outside the walls of the church? When I was in Bombay, we were worshiping in a particular church, and the church, they changed the worship timing just that particular Sunday to have an increased time of fellowship so that they can impact the city. The earlier worship timing was 10:30 to 12:30, so they increased it to 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock. More time in the church so that they can be influenced, so that they can influence the city. I happened to be speaking on that particular day, and then I told the pastor, was sitting in front, and I said, "Pastor, I want to change the worship timing slightly so that we can really make our people impact the city." And he was in the front. He said, "Go ahead, you are there on the pulpit, announce the new worship timing." So the revised worship timing was 10 o'clock to 1 o'clock, and yours truly announced the new worship timing as 1 o'clock on Sunday to 10 o'clock the following Sunday. Did any of you get it? That is the real worship timing. You can sing and dance and jump and all that and do hallelujah, praise the Lord on the podium. But the moment you get out into the world, that is where we worship. And I live in Delhi, and I can tell you one thing, in Bangalore also it is more true. Our cars are very romantic. As we take our cars out of the parking lot, suddenly the car decides to say hello to another car, bumper to bumper love. And at that point in time, you come out and you don't speak English, Tamil, Kannada or Telugu. You will speak special characters, asterisk at the rate of exclamation mark. There is that worship. When your boss does not give you the appraisal that you require, then your clouds form. That is where worship is. It is very easy, let me tell you. And we also got a very wrong concept of the word worship itself. We equate worship equal to singing and praise. Well, that is one form of worship. In fact, I've heard in several churches announcement, "We've had a nice time of worship, now let's listen to the pastor." What happened to that one? And then afterwards they will say, "Okay, worship time is over, now tea time starts." What is it? That tea time is not a worship time? Sorry. Sometimes my phone is deciding to worship. You know, everybody is charged up. But we need to understand that worship is a lifestyle. Rick Warren, that is what he says. Worship is a lifestyle of enjoying God. Now let me look at some of the other. What about family? Institutions are breaking down, and the biggest institution that is breaking down is family. Impact through the family. Impact through media. We do not have people in the print media. We do not have people in the social media. We do not have people in the television media who are honoring God. That is a matter of influence. And government. We suddenly think government is, you know, something that we should not be touching. If there is a particular wrong policy that has come out, don't blame the government. There is nobody there to influence them to come out with the right decision. We need to take the ownership. These are the seven spheres of influence that we need to have, and none of them are sin, just for your information. Let's go forward and see Matthew chapter 5 verse 13 to 14. It says very clearly, you must be the salt and the light of the earth. The problem is we are all salt, but we are in the salt shaker. Get out of the salt shaker. Sprinkle the salt and let the light. Now go forward and let us see the five tips on influencing under circumstances. I'll give you the overview. The five tips on influencing under challenges is, the first one, the rules of the secular world are secular. Daniel chapter 1 verse 4. So all these are from chapter 1. So the verse, Daniel chapter 1 verse 4. And this particular section is part of a five-part section on leading a Daniel's life in a Nebuchadnezzar's world. So I'm compressing it. The second one is that the temptations and trials that come to us on a daily basis, not on a weekly basis. The problem with many of us is we think that temptations come only one day. Temptation comes every day. And also we live what I would call a dichotomous life. You know what is dichotomous life? Monday to Friday, one type of life. Saturday, another life. And it starts actually on Friday evening. Friday evening is Poets Day. How many of you know Friday is Poets Day? Push off early, tomorrow is Saturday. Poets Day. So you unwind and then you come and bindas a Saturday, and Sunday, this is the day the Lord has made. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. And then suddenly Monday, boom, back to blah. And English language is a very funny language, let me tell you. The workstation, before I come to the workstation, the bus station is where a bus stop. The train station is where a train stops. You come to office and on your desk is a workstation. Does work stop? Life begins. Life begins. That is work. So the temptation starts on that basis. And there you will see. But what is your response? You need to resolve and take a stand. You need to resolve and take a stand. Verse 8. I memorized that in the King James Version when I started my life with the Lord. And that was, Daniel purposed in his heart not to defile himself. That is the decision that we live. We need men and God, men and women of God who are resolute to take the stand under those tough circumstances. But having taken that stand, we need to learn to address the issue, not your problem. Daniel chapter 1, verse 9. And we will see that in greater detail. And the problem with many of us is we have a tendency to spiritualize every practical issue. Whether they know, because I was a Christian, I was targeted. Why did you becoming a Christian become targeted? We are living in a competitive world. Unless you are working for a Lala company, your performance is what makes you what you are. Our surname or our name doesn't make a difference. You are good in your work, you are good in your work. There are situations, of course, where you are in strategic positions, and I've been in that situation and I know. But not always is our issues spiritual. Our issues could be something practical, and we will see that. Let's go into the details of each one of them. Okay, let's get the technology. The first one, the rules of the secular world are secular, and I'll give you the bad news. There is no believer's quota in organizations. That is the bad news. You will go to work in a secular world. Your boss will not be a believer, not necessarily. Look at the entire Old Testament or the entire Bible. The entire Bible records about 6,000 years of history. In that entire 6,000 years of history, how many believing kings were there? Old Testament and New Testament put together. How many? If you take 6,000 and if you take a 10-year span for each of them, out of 6,000, at least 600 kings should have been there. How many are there? Come on, give me some names. It's not that bad. Some names. Who said Solomon? Okay, Solomon, I'll give you the benefit of doubt. I mean, the only thing that I can think of as Solomon is, he is the only man in the Bible who could truly compliment his wife and not feel guilty about it. He could very comfortably tell his wife, honey, you're one in a thousand, and it was true. But I still give you the benefit of doubt, Solomon. Okay, who else? David. Josiah. Jehoshaphat. Hezekiah, And you look at it, and I'm telling you, I'm from Delhi, and I'll tell you, a large number of the big people, spiritual people in the Bible are all South Indians. The major prophets as well as the minor prophets, influential people are South Indians. How? Okay, yeah, how? Let me tell you. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ramayah, Jezekiah, Zephaniah, Nehemiah, all the ayahs are there. But our job is not to get a believing head of state. Our job is to be a Daniel. Our job is to be a Ruth. Our job is to be a Esther. Our job is to be a Mordecai. And therefore, I'll tell you what are the qualities you need to possess for you to get into strategic roles. This is given in Daniel chapter 1 verse 4. And the brackets are the words exactly from the Bible. And I'm giving you the corporate words that are necessary. Let me give you the 7 qualities that all of us need to have if we need to get into those 7 spheres of influence. What are those 7 qualities? The first one is age and upbringing. Upbringing is very important, and Nebuchadnezzar recognized this, that the Jews had solid upbringing. So he wanted men from nobility, young men who are from the nobility. Let us put a very heavy emphasis on our upbringing. That's very, very important. The second one is physically and medically fit. Every appointment order will have one condition. You must be medically fit. You must be also physically fit. Nebuchadnezzar wanted that, so does the people in this world want. And looking at all of you, I can give you the good news and give you a slight twist which need not be good news. Let me give you the good news. All of you are in good shape. Looking at some of you, I can say all of you are still in good shape as long as you consider round also to be a shape. We need to be physical fit. The question is, at every age, are you physically agile? About 14 years ago, I lost 14 kilos in 1 year. It was very embarrassing. Except my shoes, nothing else fitted me. I had to change my entire wardrobe. And from 36 to 35, my waist, and I couldn't change my entire wardrobe overnight. So the belt was my savior. So constantly, whenever I'm speaking, I'll be doing this. So the person in the front, he said, Anand, what's wrong with you? Why are you doing this? Isn't it embarrassing for you to keep on doing this? So I keep on doing it. And the person said, isn't it embarrassing for you to keep on doing it? I said, yes. Then why are you doing it? Because it'll be more embarrassing if I don't. But the point that I want to get across to you is, it will be embarrassing if you don't make yourself physically fit. Government of India is also my client in several departments in my current role. And they have put in a mandate, after the age of 50, every senior officer will have to produce their physical fitness certificate that goes into their personal file. If I have to be an influence, I need to not only have good upbringing, I need to be medically and physically fit. The third one is well-groomed. What is the word that is used in Bible? Handsome and presentable. I work for 3 decades in the software industry, and there are many people who came to work in the t-shirt that they slept in. There is nothing wrong with that. There is nothing right with that. You will not be presented in front of clients. Learn to be dressed for the occasion. Let us understand the concept of grooming. I don't want to dwell on it further, but write down this word and go back and Google. This word is appearance bias. There is a lot of appearance bias. How you appear is having a bias on the manager's decision making. This was a research done extensively in several of the universities in US, where they concluded that judges gave harsh judgments to people who looked a little bit ruffian type, and they gave favorable judgments to people who were looking nice, sweet, angel face kind of. The criminals inside. So we need to understand that we should not be negatively affected by appearance bias. Pay attention to grooming. That is the third one. The fourth one is learning agility. In brackets, Nebuchadnezzar actually says that they must be qualified in every kind of learning. And the word that we have is learning agility. The problem with many of us is we know only some subjects, not all subjects. We need to be informed in every kind of learning. And as the
corporate role evolves, you start with a set of competencies, but as you go, another set of competencies come, and you need to have the agility to pick up those competencies. The fifth one is general knowledge. Qualified to, you know everything, you must be well informed. The big disappointment that I've seen in many of our believing Christians is, the moment they become believers, they commit intellectual suicide. They're not informed about what is happening. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, 32, David in his kingdom, he had men of Issachar who understood the times and knew what Israel should do. Do you know what our political situation is? What is happening around as believers? Do we know what we as a church should do? For that, you need to be connected, well informed. The sixth one is mental aptitude. The seventh one is qualified to serve in the king's palace. Very few of us know how to conduct ourselves with the seniors, with the chairman or the vice chairman, with the CEO. Because there is a certain dress etiquette, there is a certain business etiquette. All the other six qualities are put to test in those few thousand nanoseconds. You will have to act. Business is happening at the speed of thought. That is Bill Gates' book. That is reality. If we have to be in influential positions, we need to have these seven qualities. Let's go forward. And now I want to ask another question, and that is, click the hyperlink, okay, and go. Okay, you can actually go to straight away, go to the screen. And the word that I want, stay with the same code, 2107, okay? 212007. The question that I want to ask you is, what is the one word that defines the corporate world which you think is not there in the Bible? Okay? Key that word and submit. What is the one word which you think, which defines the corporate world, but you think is not there in the Bible? We're not able to get it? Yeah, rat race. Okay. I'll give you the good news about the rat race. Even if you win the race, you're still a rat. Okay? Okay? Yes, boss, fast development technology, court, politics, PIP. Okay? The word cloud is forming, government, politics, loyalty. Okay? Word cloud is forming, go on, corporate. But there's one word, competitive, IoT, stress. Okay? Stress is there in the Bible. Bell curve, I told you, it's already obsolete. Okay, politics, go on. Bucket, okay, politics, so on. Okay, let's stick with the word politics, and so far 54, 55 people have answered. Let us go back to our slides. Okay, do the toggle and go back to our slides. Yeah, that's, thank you. The actual word that we expect is competition or competitive. Now I want to bring your reference to Jeremiah chapter 12, where Jeremiah is complaining to God in chapter 12 verse 1. He is saying, righteous are you, O Lord, and I would plead my case with you. Indeed, I would discuss matter of justice. That means there is so much injustice that is happening in my office. There is so much injustice happening among my colleagues. There is too much unfair competition. But God answers him in Jeremiah chapter 12 verse 5. If you have raced with men and they have worn you out, how can you compete with horses? If you stumble in a safe country and they have worn you out, how will you manage by the thickets of the Jordan? Is that a fair ask? No, the world out there is tough. Matthew chapter 10 verse 16, the Lord is saying, I am sending you as sheep among wolves. Be therefore wise as serpents and yet harmless as doves. We are not even today capable of being sheep among goats. Where is the question of wolves? You need to be that much more competitive. That is the scenario that we are in. Look at it. We must be in the world yet not of the world. I mentioned 1 Chronicles chapter 12 verse 32. We need to be in like men of Issachar who understand the times. My big frustration is very few churches are focusing our people to be able to be what I would call corporate citizens. Understanding the times and know what Israel should do. Matthew chapter 10 verse 16, I mentioned that. John chapter 17 verse 15 is the real Lord's Prayer. What is the Lord's Prayer? Not what you say, our Father in heaven. That is the disciples' prayer. The prayer that the Lord Jesus prayed for all of us is, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one. It is very easy to quit your corporate job and then say, the Lord called me. That is very easy. And I'll give you some twist on that, the Lord called me business. It's my observation. Your observation could be different. I came to know the Lord in the year 1979. From that time till today, as an Indian, I have not come across a single Indian whom the Lord has called to a country whose GDP is lesser than India. Have you come across anybody whom the Lord has called to Syria, to Sudan, to Nigeria? It's always to a country which is economically well off. No, that's not the God we are called. The God whom I believe calls us where the harvest is plentiful, not where the money is plentiful. We need to understand how we have to move in the world, but not be of the world. And here I want to bring in one concept of excellence, and I want to give you the definition. The definition is simply this. Excellence does not mean being the best. Excellence means being your best. Let me say that once again. Excellence does not mean being the best. Excellence means being your best. Now, supposing we took definition of excellence as being the best, how many people in the world can be excellent? One. Supposing we say being your best, how many people can be excellent? All of us. God wants all of us as his children to do our best. Of course, our parents, our siblings, our teachers will want us to be the best. I gave a speech in a particular parenting conference in a school, and after that, one of the parents, the mother, she came to me and she said, sir, your speech was excellent. You said that everybody can be excellent. According to my definition, everybody can be excellent. She misinterpreted it. She said, wow, that is good news. Can my son come first in class? No, I didn't say that. But she said, excellence is equal to come first in class. So I wanted to go along with her argument. I said, yes, he can. Immediately she lighted up like a light bulb. There was a halo not just on her head, all around her. And she said, yeah, you mean to say my son can come first in class? How long will it take and what must I do? It won't take much. You don't have to do anything. She said, sir, let me say that once again. Can my son come first in class? I said, yes. And she reiterated, you mean that monkey will come first in class? I mean, it wasn't a monkey, possibly a naughty boy. I said, yes, he can come first in class. So she folded her hands and she asked me, sir, what must I do for my son to come first in class? I said, simply this, put your son in a class where there's only one student. That is the problem with us. We want to drive people towards perfection and not towards excellence. And that's a very important thing. Striving for excellence is doing your best, and that motivates you. Whereas striving for perfection, which is being the best, will demoralize you. Each one of us will have to do our best. This side of eternity, we will never understand the parable of talents. Why is it that God gave one person one talent, another person two, and another person five? Our job is not to question, if I had five, I will do that. No, what will you do with the one that you had? In fact, my today morning's quiet time was in Luke chapter 17, where it talks about the person, three people having only one talent. One person produced 10 out of that, another person produced five, and another person produced nothing. Biblical mathematics you will never be able to understand. 5 + 5 is equal to 11. 2 + 2 is equal to 4, and 1 + 0 is equal to 0. Mathematically, 1 × 0 is 0. But biblically, if you don't put your talent to work, you are ineffective, and that's something that we need to understand. I want all of you, just before lunch, to do a simple exercise. I want all of you to stand up. Let's stand up. Okay? And I'm going to illustrate this principle of maximum effort. Can you all see me? Okay, I want you to do one thing, simple thing. I want all of you to raise your hand as high as you can. Now raise a little higher. What happened to you the first time? You can sit down. You have just illustrated a point which I put on the slide. People don't put in their maximum effort. despite their best intentions. They put in their best effort under compulsion or under pressure. I'll give you a simple example. This road outside our hotel is Residency Road. I ask all of you to run on that road as fast as you can. Scenario one. Scenario two, I ask all of you to run on that road as fast as you can, and after a few moments, I send a cheetah behind you. In this case, will you run as fast as you can? No prizes for guessing that one. The name of the cheetah is your boss. And I'm telling you, I thoroughly enjoyed working under tough bosses because they brought the best in me. I'll ask you a very simple question. In all our academic career, how many of us would have studied for our subjects if there were no exams? No hands are going up, neither is mine. The exam is the compulsion. The appraisal is the compulsion. The target is the compulsion. That the tougher the target is, the more the potential to bring us out. And that's the reason why I love the corporate world. I don't think and like to work for Hallelujah, Praise the Lord company. I want to work for companies which are really hardcore, brutal. They bring out the best in you. And that's when I have the opportunity to rely on the grace of God. And that's when I have the opportunity to put Philippians chapter 4 verse 13 to full effect. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There is no fun in you doing all things when the things are easy. Leaders are not made in the comfort zone. Leaders are made in the courage zone under challenges. If they influence, they are leaders. Now let's go forward and see. Okay. If you actually do your best, Proverbs chapter 22 verse 29 will be true in your life. Do you see somebody who is skilled in their work? They will serve before kings and not before officials of low rank. Our challenge is, how can we get that? Let's get into the second one and we'll quickly go on to all the other four. Temptations that come to us on a daily basis. Daniel and his four friends were called in for a management training program. It was a 3-year management training program. Day one, the test came. And what was the test? They were given food from the royal table. But they were not supposed to eat that food because of three biblical reasons. Exodus chapter 20 verse 3 very clearly said that some of the animals were sacrificed, the food was sacrificed to idols. They're not supposed to eat that. Some of the animals were unclean. Leviticus chapter 20 verse 25 said, you cannot touch those animals. And of course, some of the animals were not sacrificed according to Levitical norms. So according to Deuteronomy chapter 12 verse 23, they were not supposed to eat that meat because there was blood in it. But that was the challenge that they had to overcome. And that challenge came to them on a 3-point basis. Supposing they quit that and said, no, they asked me to eat food over to idols and had blood in it and there was unclean animals. I took a stand and I quit. And they'll come to a church like ours and we will say, praise the Lord, brother. God will honor you. But the Daniel, book of Daniel will have only one chapter, not 12 chapters. Why go to 12 chapter? We will not go up to Daniel chapter 6. What story will we tell our Sunday school children? Where is Daniel in the den of lions? Because Daniel quit before going. There are too many people who are quitters. On the other hand, they did not raise this up. They took a stand for something else. And please, no, almost all of you would not have noticed this. They did not oppose three other things, which we will be first to oppose. What are the three things that they did not oppose? The first one is they did not oppose the exile. They were actually captured. They did not oppose the exile. The second one, they did not oppose the job description. What were they asked to do? They were asked to study the language and the literature of the Babylonians. How many of us suppose, oh no, I can't do this. Well, if that is your job, you better do it or find another job. Don't quit because the job description is not, within quotes, biblical. Colossians chapter 3 verse 23 and 24. Everything that you do, you work as unto the Lord. And the third one, the name change. I mean, can you imagine? And one of the churches where I was preaching in front of me, there was a good friend of mine, his name was Mark. And from the pulpit I asked him, Mark, how will you react if tomorrow your boss called you, not Mark, but Murugan? Huh? But those are all category issues. Category 3 issues. It does not matter. What matters is how you work. So these are all issues. So having said this, what do I have as 3 rules for battle? The 3 rules of battle is this. You don't have to fight every battle. Pick your battles. Rule number 2, having engaged in a battle, you don't have to win every battle. Sense the Holy Spirit working. Learn to withdraw. But the most important one is, don't fight battles that you can easily win. If suddenly they say, your God cannot do, no problem. It's my God's responsibility. I don't have to prove a point. We need to learn to withdraw. And this is where I'm saying the 3 rules for battle. In our daily work, we need to stand up for issues that matter to our values and beliefs. We should not be an irritating jerk who's got an opinion for anything and everything. I live in Delhi. It's different from going to Delhi and doing ministry than living there. And I'm telling you, a lot of protests happen there. One place called Jantar Mantar. And I can tell you, with the current policy changes, whatever it is, I will die, fight and die for my right to read the Bible. That is an issue worth fighting for. I'll not worry about what meat I'm supposed to eat and what meat I'm not supposed to eat. I'm not worried about what is a holiday and what is not a holiday. If suddenly they declare December 25th as Good Governance Day, I will send a thank you note to the Prime Minister's office and say, thank you for recognizing the birth of our Lord as good governance, because the Bible says the government will be upon his shoulders. That is what we need to do. That is not an issue that is worth fighting for. We need to understand what are the issues that are worth fighting for, so that we stand up for the right issues, and that is where we need to get ourselves. We need to understand Jim Elliot's principle. He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. What is it that I am fighting for? Welcome to the real world. There will be trouble in this world, but Lord Jesus in John chapter 16 verse 33 said, I have told you these things so that in me you will have peace. In the world, you will have trouble. And the temptation that comes to you, God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your strength. So if you've got a tough boss, don't even ask for a prayer that that boss will be changed. Pray that you'll have the strength to bear up with that boss. If you've got a tough project, don't ask for that project to be changed. Pray that you'll have the capacity to do that project in the strength of the Lord. That is what you need. If you have a tough customer in a sales situation, don't pray that you'll have a different customer. Pray that you'll have the ability to face that customer. That is influencing under challenges. The third thing you need to do is you need to resolve and take a stand. Daniel purposed in his heart not to defile himself. Now, when you are resolving and taking a stand, we need to understand one thing. And that is, once you take a stand, you will have to diplomatically convey your stand. And before taking a stand, this is a principle that I'm asking all of you to do. Don't take a stand without a prayer backup. Take the case of Esther, chapter 4, verse 15 to 16. She was going to take a stand. And that stand was a solid stand. So if you're in an office, if you're going to go through a difficult situation, you already know that in hand, send an WhatsApp message. Send a message, and I'm sure our church is equipped with WhatsApp prayers. Tell them, I'm having a decision to take. I'm having a stand to take. Pray for me. Like Esther said, pray for me as you take a stand. And once you've taken that stand, don't worry about the outcome. In one of the organizations that I'm working for, I took my stand. My faith was very clear. In all official meetings, I did what I'm supposed to do. But the locations where the company was having the plants and offices were locations which were not even traceable on Google Maps. Our guest houses were in remote places. So many of our friends, they came and told me, Anand, you better be careful. And I'll tell you one thing. In my experience in the last 37 years in corporate life, the biggest opposition has come from fellow Christians. They come and said, blah, blah, blah. One person said, Anand, there are a lot of right-wing people in the organization. You better be careful. They will harm you. I said, no problem. One person, he came and said, they will attack you. They may kill you. I got worked up. No, they cannot kill me. Now I want to tell you openly. Nobody can ever kill a Christian. Let me say that once again. Nobody can ever kill a Christian. They can only change the address from earth to heaven. That's all. You are anyway going to go there. Now I've got good news and bad news. Which one do you want? Good news. Okay, the good news is all of you are going to die. The bad news is I don't know how you're going to die. You may die of cancer, you may die of diabetes, you may die of old age, you may die of accident, or you may just die. How about dying serving the Lord? Don't ever hesitate to take a decision saying your job will go. Don't ever hesitate to take a decision to take a stand for the Lord saying that your livelihood will go. God is going to honor you. You take the stand. Only caution is make sure that there is a prayer backup. Billy Graham said, courage is contagious. When a brave man takes a stand, the spines of others are stiffened. We need more and men and women who take a stand on solid issues, on issues that are mattering and affecting their faith in their day-to-day basis, in those seven spheres of influence. We need to have those people. People who take a stand and say, we will not produce movies for the sake of producing movies. We will produce value-based movies. We will not produce music which is just junk music. We will produce value music. We will not get into education, for example. We will not just have an educational institution for the sake of educational institution. We need to be there to make an influence. We need people who take a stand. The fourth one is, when you're addressing the issue, make sure that you address the issue and not your problem. Look at Daniel chapter 1, verse 9, and then later on verse 12 and 13. Why were they asked to eat that food? Was it because Nebuchadnezzar wanted these people to defile themselves? Yes, no, maybe I'll do some research and get back to you. Let me say that once again. When Nebuchadnezzar asked them to eat that food, did it happen because Nebuchadnezzar wanted these people to compromise their faith? No. It is because that was the best thing. They wanted to look good. That testimony will come out in a church like, no, they asked me to eat food offered to idols. Well, that is your problem. That is not their problem. So we need to understand, we need to address the issue. What was the issue? They must look healthy. So how did they address the issue? They said, give us nothing to eat but vegetables and nothing to drink but water. And I'll tell you the difference between addressing the issue and addressing the person. Whenever we look at a situation, we need to learn to address the issue, not the person. I'll ask you a simple question. Have all of you told a lie?
Yes. Okay, if you have not, that's the first lie.
Have all of you told many lies?
Yes.
There's no discomfort in this conversation. Now let me make it uncomfortable. I'm talking to a bunch of liars. How did that happen? So far, when I address the issue, you have told a lie. You're addressing the issue. But the moment you attack the person, I mean, man, I may have said something, and I'm only a saved sinner. If you come to a judgment, you are this kind of a person. I mean, that is wrong. I have seen pastors come to that conclusion. I said, what's wrong with you? What do you preach on a Sunday? Do you judge the person or you judge the issue? We need to be very careful with our office situation. The issue has to be addressed. Don't attack the person. My boss is a non-Christian. He is asking me to do this. No, he is asking you to do that because that was what was required there. That is the important thing. So learn to address the issue and not your problem. And here I want to give you the golden guideline. When we are faced with challenges, all of us are faced with challenges. Some of us are given and compromise. Others give up and quit. But a few are like Daniel who conquer and go up. Let's get the fifth one as we go forward. When we are addressing the issue, don't spiritualize a practical issue. What was the issue? The issue, they did not have to bring God into that picture. They could have said, our Pentateuch, they did not have the Bible at that point in time, Daniel. Our Pentateuch says we must not eat food offered to idols. We must not eat unclean animals. We must not touch meat with blood in it. But would it matter to the Nebuchadnezzar or the people of Babylon? No, they had to address. They did not have to bring God. You know, we are very quick to bring God into the situation. People come and ask me, Anand, you are in all these secular companies, you are in all these parties. Do you drink? I said, yes, let me drink also, so that you get candleized. I drink 3 liters. What I drink is my problem. Don't say, no, I go to church, I don't drink. Then they ask you, what they did, they serve you in communion. You're getting yourself into problem. Or take the other case, you know, The 11th commandment. Do you smoke? No, no. Boss, I'm a Bible-believing Christian. I don't smoke. Well, let me give you. I memorized. Any of you know the 11th commandment? Let me give you the 11th commandment. I memorized just in King James English. Thou shalt not smoke. If thou shouldest smoke, thou shalt not exhale. Because the Lord thy God is a consuming fire. Is there a verse like that? Nothing. Don't spiritualize your everyday issues. They will ask you to do what is right in their sight. You consider it not right. Bring the name of God when it is necessary. Take the case in Daniel chapter 1 verse 12. He could have brought the name of God. He did not say our God prohibits us. He just said we need to be looking healthy. We will look healthy. Whereas in the case of the interpreting of the dreams, there is nobody but God. Bring God in when he is relevant. And that's why I say, let your spiritual life be natural and your natural life be spiritual. And in closing, while I still have 32 seconds, I want to tell you, let your career be the carrier of the gospel. That is my motto. We'll do one last command. Let us see if we can get that into work. Where are your challenges? So go back and see there are four options. We may not have time for that. We will do it later on. 13 minutes are there. We will do this later on. Go back to the slide and let us rest with let your career be the carrier of the gospel. I want to thank you for your attention.